To Stirring the Cauldron. Now, here's your host, Marla Brooks.
Hey, Merry Meet everybody, and welcome to Stirring the Cauldron here on Para X Radio. And on this Thanksgiving night, I hope you're all stuffed to the gills with turkey and all the trimmings, and are ready to sit back, relax, and be thankful for all the blessings that we've had this past year. And you know, if you look really closely, even some of those not so great things that have happened could actually be blessings in disguise. And in this continuous search that we're always on, looking for answers to some of life's tough questions or predicaments, there's one amazing power that we can call upon to give us a better understanding of life and how to go about it, living it to our benefit, and that is Kabbalah. And who better to explain what Kabbalah is all about than my friend, astrologer, psychic, past life therapist, Kabbalist, and teacher, David Wells. Hi, David, and welcome.
Hello, Marla. You missed out the bit about being a really good pastry chef.
Oh, yes, the cakes. How could I forget the cakes? Oh, my God. Well, now you're going to have to just send some recipes. You know that's going to happen.
Indeed, and happy Thanksgiving to you.
Well, thank you very much. And since it is a day of thanks, I'm really thankful that you're here with me tonight. So there, even though you don't celebrate Thanksgiving, but you do have lots of blessings that you're aware of and you acknowledge them. And one of the things is Kabbalah. And I'm going to admit right up front that I thought I knew something about it. Now I know that I know next to nothing about it. And I did what everybody else who is interested in finding things out would do. I tried to do my homework, but it wasn't as easy as I thought it would be because I got so much conflicting information that I'm really not a whole lot better off than when I started. And if you'll bear with me a minute, I'm going to explain some of the things that I found out. And when I'm done, you can either say that I'm a complete idiot for not getting it, or you can untangle all of these kind of crossed wires and set things straight, or both.
Okay.
Up to you. All right. Well, first of all, there's some confusion between Kabbalah with a K and Kabbalah with a Q, which is the one we're going to be talking about tonight. Now, some references say that they are one and the same, except that Kabbalah with a K is Jewish Kabbalah, and Kabbalah with a Q, otherwise known as mystical or hermetic Kabbalah, is the Christian or English equivalent. Then, others claim that Kabbalah with a Q is spelled that way only by occultists and used in practical magic. And another source says that Kabbalah with a Q is the secret doctrine of the Jews handed down throughout the ages by the great teachers to their beloved disciples under a very solemn vow of secrecy. But that contradicts the first statement I read, that Jewish Kabbalah is spelled with a K. And then another source states that while all the different spellings all stem from the same origins, they are entirely different. And that contradicts the statement that all Kabbalah is the same. So perhaps you can see my dilemma here.
Oh, yes, I can definitely see your dilemma. And despite the fact you're not actually saying it properly, I mean, let's begin there.
Oh, see? Oh!
I'm teasing you. I know that in America they do say Kabbalah. Here we say Kabbalah. And it is sometimes spelled that way as well, isn't it? It's sometimes spelled C-A-B-A-L-A or C-B-L-A-A, all sorts of things.
They said there were 20 different versions of spelling.
I could well believe that. The one that I study, the Q, as it's affectionately called, you're right in saying they all stem from the Jewish tradition. They absolutely, I think that's what they would all agree with. But it's it's like astrology. There's different house systems and different ways of learning astrology. I think for me, you're right that the Q is also more of a Western tradition. It's more of a mystic tradition. Mm-hmm. But it's... I think the thing with it, Marla, is part of its journey has been in the confusion because, as we all know, historically, occult knowledge, and occult simply means hidden. There's nothing, there's nothing dark or intrinsically evil, for want of another word, about that. It just simply means hidden knowledge. Mm-hmm. The best way to hide something is, of course, to make it confusing.
Yes.
I mean, that's its very root. And it's also, remember, traditionally a spoken tradition. So therefore, a lot of it hasn't been written down. And in fact, when I learned Kabbalah here in England, you may have the occasional handout, has to be said, but in 11 years of learning it every week for 11 years, my teacher would tell us, she would impart it verbally. She would give us the information verbally. Mm-hmm. And she, in turn, had been taught by Israel Regardi. So, it is a tradition that's come through like a storytelling tradition. Mm-hmm. So all of the statements you made are true.
Oh, thank you. That clears it up.
But here's the deal. As with all things, there's many paths to enlightenment, isn't there? Mm-hmm. I'm sure you'd be the first to agree with that. And there's many different ways within all sorts of structures, but it's the structural point for me that's important about the Kabbalah, because it puts that crystal course that you went to last week, and 3 years ago you did a bit of healing, and a couple of years ago you did a tarot course, and then I did a bit of past life. It puts all of that into one structure, which is called, of course, the Tree of Life, which is the central symbol for all of those doctrines you mentioned. The Tree of Life is a central symbol. So it takes all of those things that you've learned and you want to learn. Everything in the universe is on that single symbol of the Tree of Life. Mm-hmm. And if worked as a symbol and as a structure, it gives you learning and therefore your enlightenment, if you like, a path to follow rather than a kind of bit of this, bits of that, bits of the other. That for me, it kind of says it all about the Kabbalah.
Okay, well, see, that's the other thing about the Tree of Life as well, because I went looking for graphics of the Tree of Life. And some of them were very kind of new agey looking. Others had all this Hebrew writing and all the Malkuth and all that stuff on it. And so, because I was going to actually put it on a banner that I made, but there were too many trees and they were all too different. So I didn't know which one to use. There went again. it's really interesting. And I read a quote about the tree. Now, see, this does sound kind of mystical and makes you stop and think. And it said that the tree of life's end is contained within its beginning, and its beginning contained within its end. That, is a little bit of food for thought, right?
That's essential to the tree. It continues like a Jacob's ladder, so the one tree is just a very small part. And within each, the circles you have in the Tree of Life, they're called Sephiroth in plural, Sephara in singular. But each mm-hmm. Sephara has another tree inside it, and each Sephara in that tree has another. It's ad infinitum, and that's mm-hmm. the beauty of it.
Mm-hmm.
It just goes on and on, and that's the way your spiritual journey works. I recently had an email from someone who didn't want to receive any of my newsletters because they said, I've reached the end of my spiritual learning.
Oh.
And I was very tempted to write back and say, Dear God, nice to see you.
Because, I know, I was just thinking the same thing. No aura, all gone, ready to pass. Yeah.
Yeah, it's one of those things that never ends, and the tree fits that. The tree will allow you to explore it and to move amongst its branches as much as you want to. And it, at every turn, it will give you new fruit. It will absolutely give new fruit every time. Mm-hmm. Get me being all poetic.
Oh, I love it. But you are, anyway. You just kind of hide it well sometimes. Now, it's my understanding that, I'm trying to say it the right way, and I'm not going to do it. Kabbalah?
Kabbalah.
Kabbalah, okay. Doesn't offer fixed ideas, but rather a training in new ways to think. What are the basic tenets then?
Well, I think what it does is it opens you up to the truth of the world in which you live, the way in which the mechanics of the universe work. So it begins with very basics, like the elements, earth, air, fire, and water, and how we're made up of that. It then moves on to those spheres, those sephara, the sephiroth, are the planets, and the paths in between are the tarot cards, so the major arcana of the tarot. And all of those things, as you are well aware, are about human conditions. It's about human experiences. Mm-hmm. And the way in which they're linked makes sense when you start to work it and walk up and down the tree, you understand. But I think for me, the way it really works and how it teaches is it attracts it into your life. It physically comes into your life. And that's how it worked. Certainly the way that I learned it, it worked like that for me. It stood right in front of me. There was no escaping it.
So do you start at like a basic point on that tree, like at the root base or something, and then work your way up and spread out as you go?
You do. Well, you start at the very bottom, which is called Malkuth, M-A-L-K-U-T-H. And that's the physical world, because that's where we live. We live in the physical world. Mm-hmm. You then, the way that I was taught, and certainly the way that I teach others, is you then visit each of the sephara in turn, and look at the experience of the powerhouses. If you imagine they're like generators, these spheres generate energy that then shoots up and down the paths. You learn about all the sephara, and you have these wonderful journeys, and you go and visit the spectacular temples that are built up around these experiences. Mm-hmm. Then you start working on the paths. So the major arcana become the path workings that join the tree. So you have 22 of those to go up and down. Then when you get to the top again, you come back down and you bring all that power down with you. So you see how it can take years to learn.
And I think everybody kind of does it in their own time, right? It's not like, okay, you got to learn this by next week sort of thing.
No, not at all. Absolutely. It is absolutely. Even if you work in a group, of course, you only ever go as fast as your slowest member. Mm-hmm. And that changes. Someone can have a really amazing experience, say, for example, in Malkuth, and it's very easy for them. But then they get higher up to the soul level, which is right in the middle of the tree, at Tifereth. And they can't get past Tifereth. They find it very difficult. So the rest of the group would then move in around and support them and enable everyone to then move forward.
Mm-hmm. Now, do you call yours the Hermetic Qabalah? I'm never going to be able to do this, so never mind.
Just say the Q. The Q.
Yeah, the Q. There we go. Thank you so much. because, you know, like I said, it's called by so many things. And I think a lot of people, well, one of the other things I read, and here we go again, and smack me if I'm wrong, that it is the precursor to the neo-pagan Wiccan and New Age movements, and does have a great deal to do with the astral or magical world, and actually was made popular in more current times by Aleister Crowley. Is that right?
That's very true. Yeah, absolutely. The ritual work and the magical side of the Q is very famous. Mm-hmm. It can be as in-depth or as perhaps light as you want to make it. For me, it's I would, for example, when I'm doing a temple working, I would go for full bells and whistles and smells. I wouldn't scrimp on any of that, but I draw the line at dressing up.
Darn.
maybe a robe now and again, but certainly not, anything beyond that. Well, maybe a bit of lipstick, but, but some people, there's a great book written by one of your guys over there. I can't remember his name. I think it's Christopher Prenzak, and he's written The Witch's Qabalah, which is an enormous book. Witchcraft or the craft and wicked certainly has its place within the Qabalah. But then so does every other religion. It is, as you said right at the very beginning, there's Judaism, there's also Christianity, there's a Buddhist Qabalah, there's a Christian Qabalah. So, just to add even more confusion for you there, Marla, all those things exist within it. And for me, that was one of the pulls. I had people in my group who were who were quite strong Christians or Catholics, and it didn't matter. I lean more towards, as you know, the pagan side of things, but it's totally irrelevant. The Qabalah isn't about a faith, a religion, or a cultism. It's nothing about that. It's about life. you know, it's there's no haftas with it. You know, it's not on a Sunday do this and a Thursday do that. It's a use me, just use the power that you've got and you understand and unfold the truth of who you really are as a human being and a human doing, you know.
That's hard to do because some of us really, well, I'm not speaking for myself, but some people really don't want to know because they're afraid to find out.
Then so, don't look.
Yeah, exactly. Don't look. Well, you know, the other thing, you know, you're talking about the witchcraft element in it. Another thing I was reading was about the lesser banishing ritual of the pentagram, which is used quite a bit with the Q at times. And, you know, it's something that we witchy folk use to either purify a room or for ritual work or a meditation and also for protection. Mm-hmm. But I was, you know, the lesser ritual that we use maybe should be called the lesser simpler ritual because we just call down the archangels. But I was reading that Qists also perform the Kabbalistic, never mind, I'm going to have to say it one way or the other, bad or not, Kabbalistic cross, which is not part of the simplified version that we do. And just for people that know, it's kind of like crossing yourself in Catholicism, but there's a little more to it. So maybe you should explain what the cross is and what it's used for in certain rituals.
You are right. The Kabbalistic cross is central to opening up a temple or, you know, a powerful meditation. And we use the archangels too. And I don't know, do you use the before me Raphael, behind me Gabriel?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's what we use as well.
Right.
And I think probably as Kabbalism is way over 2,500 years old, we maybe got there first, quite frankly, but but it's not a competition. But what you're talking about, the Kabbalistic crosses, people often ask me, you know, from when they used to watch, when I used to be on Most Haunted, I would say it for protection, which is the prayer is Ate Malkuth Vegabura Vegadula Le'ulam Amen, is the prayer. And you're right, you do cross yourself when you do that. But the difference between that and the Catholic cross is you will go from above your head at Ate Malkuth, you would point to the floor. Vegabura, you would touch your right shoulder. Vegadula, you would touch your left shoulder. And then Leulam, you bring your hands together in a prayer fashion. Leulam, Amen, and you would bow. And the reason we do it the other way around is because if you have your back towards the Tree of Life, your right hand is Gabura, your right shoulder is Gabura, which is defensive. So it is aggressive, so it would carry the sword, and your left hand, Gudula, would carry the shield. Mm-hmm. So what you're actually saying is, as above, Ate, so below, Malkuth, Vegabura, as above, so below, I can't remember it now, the power, you got me all over this, the power on the right-hand side, and the glory on the left-hand side, mm-hmm. forever and ever, amen. You're actually saying the last bit of the Lord's Prayer. That's what you're saying.
Mm-hmm.
But you're actioning it by making it the sign of a huge cross, but from your head to your feet, from your right shoulder to your left shoulder, and you're imprinting that in astral vision.
Mm-hmm.
Then you say, before me, Raphael, behind me, Gabriel, my right hand, Michael, my left hand, Uriel, around me burn the pentagrams of fire, and behind me shines the sixth red star of pure white brilliance. Mm-hmm. And really, there's no greater protection. That is you. You're sealed in there and protected. So so you see how it brings in everything. You've got the elements,
mm-hmm.
You've got cross, but the Kabbalistic mm-hmm. cross. So not the mm-hmm. Christian cross, the Kabbalistic cross.
Mm-hmm.
And you have, you know, the Tree of Life built on you, really. That's what it's about.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, I accused you several times years ago about being a witch. And it's because I saw you doing the lesser banishing ritual on Most Haunted.
Yeah.
And quite well you did it without any hesitation. So, of course, I pointed it at you. And you have since explained that, you know, in a past life or two, you were. So you clearly
I was definitely a witch.
Uh-huh. Yeah, well, I think some of it's still here. But, hey, you know, the DNA goes from life to life to life. But
you should get over here for Witch Fest, you know, on a side thing. Marla, you should really. Do you have one over there? Do you have anything like that in the States? we festival have of witchcraft?
Something like that, but yeah, well, not quite as glorified as what you have, the nice, you know, the big stuff there, because I don't know, I'm not, I just, you know, I have this affinity probably because of my ancestors from the UK, so I always kind of think things are neater over there. They may be the same here, but I don't know about it. If it is, it's not local. But I do see that you attend Witchfest every year.
Yeah, and, it's November. Get over here in November. It's the 12th next year, so get over here.
Oh, that gives me a year to plant. Good. Okay. That sounds like a good
idea. Do the show from there, live from Witchfest.
Oh, wouldn't that be? Oh, that would be so cool.
Be great.
Absolutely be so cool. Going to try to do that.
Sorry, I digress.
I digress all the time. Hey, and this is just clearing my head because I've got more confusing things to talk to you about here.
Okay.
But, all right. So here again, another thing that I picked up, another quote, that it teaches that there is only one great being, one self who is the whole universe. This one being is all that was, is, or will be. And that Qists are not content with an eternal dichotomy between divine and devil. They believe in one without a second. Who you are is that same one, and there is no other. Now that could take a little bit of explanation.
So what they're basically saying there is that there is no evil, there is no devil.
Mm-hmm.
That it's all one. That there is the darkness and the light are all one being. That's essentially what that's saying.
Mm-hmm.
I think for me, and certainly when I was learning the Q, and my personal belief is I have no faith in there ever being a devil. I think that's created by man as a fear mechanism, because of course you give people something to be frightened of. It still continues, and many devils created daily, but we won't go into that one in this conversation. But there are because the human condition is that we appear to need something to transfer that side of ourselves to, rather than to understand that we all have that in us, and that we will have through lifetimes negated it. And we have those thoughts that cross our minds now and again, which, okay, they're not way down there on the bottom end of evil scale, but they're certainly on the not very pleasant scale. We all have those thoughts now and again. But what the Q teaches us is that when you veer towards the light side, that things in your life will absolutely will go easier for you. They will go easier because you're not struggling through the toffee of those darker thoughts and darker energies that will be attracted to you, and they will be attracted to you. You know, it's a thing about the astral worlds as well. If you think about, we're a denser form of the astral worlds and a slower form of the astral worlds. We can't, for example, we can't think and it just becomes. We can think and eventually it becomes, but we can't just think cake and there a cake appears. We think cake.
Darn it.
Yeah, I know. Maybe it's a good thing. We think cake, and then we think, oh, got to get the flour, got to get the butter, got to go to the shop, buy a cake. But it then becomes. So we are a denser form, if you like, the astral world. So the same goes for light and dark. If we are dark in this life, and if we allow ourselves to get caught up in the trap of being miserable and not trying harder or dismissing things that really aren't that important, what will happen is more of that dark will come towards us. It will be attracted to us, just as it would be on the astral planes. But if we shine like you do on the astral planes, if you really shine, the darkness just moves past you because it can't see you. It just goes right past you. And the same as it is in life, if we shine, which is what the Kabbalah tries to teach us, if we shine, then what will happen is light will come towards us. And that's essentially what that says. It says there is darkness and there is shadow, but if you live in the light, light will come.
Mm-hmm. Which is a very hard thing to do. I mean, given daily routines and conditions beyond our control. But
that's the lesson, is it not? That's part of it. Again, that's what the Q teaches, isn't it? It gives you the tools, I think, to overcome quite a lot of the hurdles. And it will put them in front of you. You know, I had some very difficult times throughout my formal training. I don't think, you know, like I said earlier, you never finish the training. But during the formal part of it, I had some terrible times. You know, I'm an eighth, for astrologers, I'm an eighth house sun. I'm also Scorpio rising. So there's a lot of doerness, as we say in Scotland. You're a bit doer. There's a lot of that in my chart. And I had a bit of it to overcome, you know, I really did. But the cue held my hand and took me through that, you know.
Mm-hmm. Well, and one of the other things that I found kind of neatly interesting was that the act of creation was not just a one event many eons ago that's now over and done with, but actually a continuing process which is still happening today and which we can help play a role in either hindering or helping the manifestation of the divine. I mean, most people think they're helpless to do anything.
Yeah, and again, I agree with you. A lot of people sometimes say, what can I do? But it begins also with you. It begins with the individual. It begins by saying, what I can do is be the best me. Mm-hmm. I can be, you know, and to, I think, understand, one of the things it really taught me was it's not a competition. Mm-hmm. Like, well, there is a competition, but only against yourself. It doesn't matter if Jimmy down the road's got 15 Porsches and 400 yachts and 65 Learjets at his command, because you know what? He may be as miserable as sin. He absolutely could be. Might have nothing. But and I know it's an old cliche, but that's the truth of it. And I think what it teaches you is it starts with you. So if you, by being as upbeat and by being as in the light as you can, you go to the you go to a supermarket and someone's having a really bad day and you simply go, hello, morning. You know, at some silly time in the morning, because they're up at silly time for work, the same as you. And you've switched their whole day around. That's how it works. You know, just by saying good morning to them, you've switched their whole day around. If you want to take it further, then you have to build your confidence. You have to build your understanding. You have to build your knowledge. And you have to be able to take knocks. And again, the Kabbalah will stand beside you. And, you know, working in the media, as you know, and working on TV, there are plenty who are willing to stand there with a big stick and try and beat you down. You then have to learn to say, okay, well, it's your opinion, but here's mine. So, you know, I think you are right. It's not easy. It's not easy, and there's lots of negative things. But I'll tell you what, I'll share a little tip with you on that one. Switch your telly off. Switch the TV off. You know, don't listen to the news, because it's going to bombard you with stuff that you will feel helpless. And by feeling helpless, you'll make yourself helpless. You know, it's like fat clothes and thin clothes in your wardrobe. You know?
Speaking of cakes, yes.
Speaking of cakes, if you've got a load of beautiful clothes that, let's face it, you're never going to see again, they're just not ever going to fit you again. Having them hanging in your wardrobe says, oi, fatty, do you remember when you used to be able to get into this? Yeah. Get rid of them. Then they're not there going, you know? Get rid of them. And your confidence goes up a mile high and you think, oh, room for more cake.
Yeah, I think I'd take the cake over the clothes, you know. It's a special thing, but, you know.
But it is, I don't think it's not meant to be a struggle. I think, you know, because then we get into the psyche of, oh, life is such a struggle. But it is meant to be a challenge, you know, because it's a test, yeah, it's a resolve, you know.
And what you're kind of saying is that we all have a great, wonderful habit of shooting ourselves in the foot.
Oh, absolutely. And it is, you know, something my teacher would say, fantastic teacher, Jenny Shaw, would say all the time is, there is always, always, David, usually, one thing you can change, and that's your attitude.
Mm-hmm. And that's the hardest thing to change. Because it's ingrained, and I think some of us, I mean, I think we all have a wee bit of masochism in us. You know, we don't deserve this, and we shouldn't do this, and, you know, this and this and this, that all the things that we've been taught, and some of that baggage just never gets dropped when you come to the age of reason and can think for yourself.
I think it's shoulda, woulda, coulda, you know, the shoulda, woulda, coulda of life. If you're thinking, I should do this, or I ought to do this, then you don't want to do it. Because you should be thinking, I'm looking forward to this, or, yeah, I'm going to do that. It should have, would occur, you don't. So therefore, you have to try and change it. So if it's someone should get up and go to work, I suppose, then clearly, you know, if you're feeling like that, you need to change what you do. And I know that's not easy. I know I ran around a restaurant for years serving chips, and I was in the Royal Navy, for goodness sake. Do you know what I mean? Before I found what I really wanted to do. And there are still days when I wake up and think, oh, astrology, how many words have I got to write? There are still days like that. But then I remind myself how lucky I am to be doing what I do. But that didn't happen because I didn't try. It didn't fall out of the sky and just land on my lap.
Right.
You know, it happened because I shifted my attitude, because I put myself into the right places. I learned what I had to learn. And I pushed, you know, and I pushed and I pushed for what I wanted. That's how it happened. It didn't happen because someone was walking down the street and went, hello, young man, know anything about astrology? Here's the television show. You know, it didn't happen like that. I think that's the thing. You know, find what you're good at and keep doing it. And even if you're running alongside something that pays the bills, eventually it will take over. I promise you, it will take over. If you keep pushing and keep pushing. It's not easy, though. I know there are times you think, how many more times do I have to push? You know?
Well, I think also people sometimes, and we all are guilty of this, I think, are in the mentality that there is just certain things that we have to do, whether we like it or not, you know.
Absolutely. And change your attitude with that and put a smile on your face and think, well, I'm doing it because I need to eat, you know, because I need a roof over my head. I need to do this, and that's fine. Yeah.
Yeah, but I do agree with you. There's an evolution waiting in all of us to come out if we let it. You know, you go from one thing to another. I mean, you know, you start something and all right, you're doing astrology, and then, you know, you find an interest in the tarot and you do this and that, and you grow. And some of the things that you try, you're not maybe going to, it's not going to be a perfect fit. But there may be something, if you just keep on going, that hits you, you know, on top of the head, and you go, that's it. And I've been looking for that for a really long time. That's but right. As you said, you won't find it unless you look.
And that's what the cue affords you. It gives you a plan and a time to, you know, you're looking at your own astrology through the Sephara. You're looking at your own tarot, really, through the major arcana, and which paths suit you and which don't. And each time you do them, remember, you're attracting things towards you. So, you know, say for example, you're working hard and you get to the chariot path. So you're on the chariot path in the Kabbalah, which is quite high up, it has to be said. And things start to change for you as the chariot dictates professionally. You know, it can bring career breaks towards you. But that path, for example, is between it's between Gabura and Bina. So you've got Gabura, which is karma and action and getting it sorted, and Bina, which is about strong structures, controls, and even rules. So you see how once you get up that high and you think, I'm going to take action, I'm going to change the rules, I'm going to make the rules work for me. The Kabbalah then puts that opportunity, really does put it in front of you and says, okay, there you go, big boy, off you go. And you seize that opportunity, which is the chariot path.
You just have to allow yourself to seize it, though.
Yeah, you do. But by that time, you'll have gone through some stuff, I tell you. By that time, you're thinking, yeah, okay, I've heard it. This is what I'm meant to do. I'm going there.
You get that karmic kick in the head or something.
Definitely. If it's coming from Gabura, which is Mars, the planetary force of Mars. And, you know, and you think about, well, think angelic, archangels, Hamael, some people pronounce it. And he's a knight in shining armor that just says, okay, boys, this way. And I only just realized this the other day there, actually, because the archangels sit on the tree of life. And I've been talking about the archangels and doing new workshops based around them. But I've only just realized that, they are our ancient gods, are they not? Mars is Hamael. He's an ancient god of Mars. And, you know, Apollo, the sun god, is Michael, the archangel Michael.
Yeah.
You know, I only just twigged that after how many years of studying. I suddenly went, hang on a minute, aren't they the name of the god? You know, so it doesn't always sink in first time round, that's for sure.
You had an epiphany, and I think that's a good thing.
I did. It was great. Don't get one of those very often these days.
Well, you know, the other thing that I was reading, again, here I'm doing too much reading and not enough understanding, that most start the study of the cue at an early age because it's kind of a lifelong pursuit. Does that mean that someone older might miss out on some things, or can they study harder and catch up?
You know, traditionally in the Jewish you would have to be over 40. So you'd have to be over 40. You'd have to be Jewish, and you would have to be male.
I know. Yeah.
So you know, I don't know. I don't think someone very young would be able to appreciate it. I think it's something that comes later in life, and when you've had some experience to look back and reflect on. I would be very surprised if someone, even in their teens, could get to grips with some of the philosophies and the teachings of the Q. I'm not suggesting they can't learn the words, they can't learn the structure, and they can't understand and learn its processes, but I think experience goes a very long way of having had the experiences. Goes a very long way to you then reflecting upon how you can change that preconditioning. So I think come to the queue at any age, and even if you leave after 2 weeks, you've learned something, you know. But you never stop learning it. But I think experience of life would be a prerequisite to actually having a lot of value from it.
Well, what drew you to it in the beginning?
It was something to do on a Wednesday night, really. No, that's a not very magical answer, is it?
For you, it is.
It was actually, I remember I had that whole near-death experience. I was in my 30s. I was about 33, 34. And the first thing that happened when I came out of hospital was paranormal stuff. And very often paranormal is where your awakening begins. You know, it might end somewhere differently, but it's all the things that go bump in the night and the noise is off and a shift in your awareness. And then I started to learn astrology with a group of people here in Portsmouth. And then my teacher, the astrological teacher at the time, who wasn't Jenny Shaw, but had gone through the Kabbalah, had mentioned Kabbalah to the group that I was learning astrology with. And all of us went to learn the Kabbalah with some new people as well. And that's how it began, really. It was part of the umbrella of the organization, which is now the Order of the White Lion, but was then MART or MAT. And so it was a kind of organic thing. It just kind of grew. Astrology then came Kabbalah. So it kind of, for me, it was the right place at the definite right time, because an amazing experience that, to be honest, I don't think many people could repeat. Who can give over 11 years to being taught these days, you know?
Mm-mm. 11 minutes, much less 11 years.
Oh, and that is the problem.
Okay, well, here's the other thing. You know, you were talking about first came the psychic, then the astrology, then, you know, the Q. There are people out there that have many gifts and many interests. But we all know that we can't do everything well. Mm-hmm. And some people just try to pile it on and pile it on and pile it on. How do people go about finding what the gift that they have is? You know, like there will be a main gift and then there will be, you know, a couple of branches off in different directions.
Oh, I see what you did then with the branches. Very good. Tree of life and all that.
I learned quickly. But it's true. Some people try to be too many things. What would your suggestion be to finding the right things that are for you and knowing when to quit, kind of thing?
I think, you know, for me, that's what the cue provided, really, because you have a look at numerology, geomancy, you have a look at obviously tarot, astrology, all sorts of doctrines, and see which one resonates most with you. I think you need to be honest. If you, for example, want to become a television medium, and actually mediumship's not your bag, you know what, then maybe you just need to actually forget about being famous. That's the first thing. And then just go with what really truly is your bag, because that's the thing that will bring you notoriety if that's what you're actually after. I think you try things until you find what just seems to fit you. I don't think there's anything wrong with trying lots of things.
No.
It's when you try to pretend that you are great at everything or you spread yourself so thinly that you can't do everything. You know, sometimes that's a finger that's pointed at me, because I do tarot, I do past life astrology and the Kabbalah. My answer to that, of course, is a very simple one. Actually, I don't do all those things. I do one thing, and that's the Kabbalah. That's what I do, because I could be talking astrology, but my head is actually thinking Kabbalah, or I could be reading tarot, but my head is thinking Kabbalah. So I think it's finding the one thing or two things that you do really well and throwing yourself at that. Primarily, though, it comes down to you and your interests. Don't do it for anyone else. Do it for yourself.
No,
and if you do it for yourself.
Yeah, and a lot of people do things for the wrong reasons. They do it because either it's cool or because, you know, they want to shine really bright, not realizing that, you know, lightning will strike eventually. It's just, you know, you just hear so many people, I'm this and this and this, and they wear a multitude of hats.
Yeah, but, and pendants.
And pendants, yes, oh yeah. And there is no umbrella to, like you said, the Q is your umbrella. You know, these are byproducts of that. But most, I think, don't have that umbrella. It's just, I'm this, I'm this, I'm this, I'm this, I'm this, I'm this. And by the time they get through being this and this and this, you get tired because you don't know who they were to begin with. And I doubt that they do either.
Now, I agree with you. I mean, I hear people say, oh, I'm a medium. I'm a soul retrievalist. Go figure. I'm an exorcist this week. And you think, well, you know, last week you were a dancer. But it's, you know, I agree with you. The secret for me is what make it about yourself, first of all. What is it that you are passionate about? What actually, when you make a discovery in amongst your teachings, makes you go, oh, my goodness, I never thought about things that way. And that's what the Q does for me. And astrology still does it for me. And tarot still does it for me. And past life work still does that for me. I get people who come for readings or people who come for past lives, or I'm studying for books or whatever. And I think, well, I never thought of it that way. That's what. That's why I do it, really.
Those are the golden moments when something like that happens. Those moments that all of a sudden, boink, hit you, that were so simple, but you overlooked for whatever reason. But then I always say they come to you because it's time for you to learn. You know,
like the archangels being gods.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. You didn't need to know that until last week. It was
until Cardiff.
You know, Jill Cardiff, yes. I mean, it's neat when those things happen and kind of fascinating. And it's one of when things like that happen to me, all of a sudden I stop and I smile. You know, it's just like, whoa, this is very cool, you know.
And you know what's really great about those moments, Marla, is it's personal.
Yeah.
It's actually a personal moment. It's a kind of, it's almost like you've been given that gift personally by your guides, by God, by whoever you want to attach that to. But it's a kind of look at this, and that a veil's parted, and it isn't actually for anyone else. It's just for you. And I think that's what's amazing. That's why we smile and think thank you.
Yeah. Exactly, because we realize that, and it's really important.
Definitely.
It was, you know, we were talking about things that people want to be. You know, I want to be an astrologer. I want to be this. I want to be that. But, you know, I was talking to someone. I did somebody's show the other day, and they were saying, well, you know, who are you? What are you? You know, what is a witch? Blah, 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 blah. And, you know, first of all, you know me. I hate labels. I do, you know, because they just get all sullied and tattered at the edges, and it's just not right. But, you know, I just kind of came to the conclusion a long time ago that that part of me is not what I wanted to be. It's who I am. And it was my decision whether to deny it or embrace it. And I think that's it with a lot of people. They need to understand first who they are before they decide to put out there what they want to be or what they will be. You know, I mean, I think it's just so much easier to make a flat statement without looking inward and figuring out you before you figure out, you know, where you're going and what you're going to be, kind of.
I do agree with you. And I think that's, again, the beauty of the Q is that it begins in personality. It begins by deconstructing, essentially, your personality and rebuilds it in a different way, in a more honest way, really. Then it progresses to your soul. Then it progresses, you know, to your spiritual self. And I think you're absolutely right. Begin with yourself. I think, you know, we kind of said that earlier, really. But deconstruct yourself as in, you know, your preconditioning in this life, your past lives, your true beliefs. And don't, like you said, the labels are sullied. So perhaps if there's a part of the craft or a part of Wicca or a part of Buddhism or whatever you're into that actually don't agree with or doesn't sit comfortably then don't accept it just because it comes under the banner of, you know, but you can still call yourself a Buddhist if you want to, or Wiccan, obviously call yourself that, but you can, you don't have to accept the doctrines at all. And, you know, something I impart to my students, certainly my students of the queue, is listen to what I have to tell you, and I will pass on as best I can this information. If you don't agree with it, say so, and then we could maybe talk it out. But if you still don't agree with it, that's absolutely fine. I'm not offended. I'm not offended at all, and the Kabbalah certainly won't be offended, you know. So I think you're right. You need to, you know what it is, Marla? It's the Temple of Adelphi, written over it in Astral Sight, is Know Thyself. And that's the first rule, isn't it? Know thyself.
Yeah. And, you know, like we mentioned before, there's a lot of people that are afraid to know themselves. But I, okay, so here's the other question, though. All of a sudden I had a memory flash. You were talking about past lives, which is a great way to know yourself. Is something like that, do you think, necessary to know your past before you can successfully complete your future or your current status?
I don't know whether it's essential, but I would think that anyone who's on a spiritual quest would be intrigued. I think they would want to know. Certainly your key life, you know, the one that seems to be affecting this life more than most, or perhaps getting back to the gift question earlier, that, you know, you're kind of what you're particularly good at. That can very much be carried forward from a past life. So if you're having questions over that, then a past life could help you with that. I think that it's not essential, but I would highly recommend it, because without, I think, a lot of the past life knowledge I have of my own, from my own past lives, I think I would lack understanding. There would be great holes in the understanding of myself, and certainly of my soul's journey. And if I know where it's come from, I know where it's kind of heading, you know, I know where my soul wants to take me, and I want to go with it. I want my personality to be able to get the soul there, you know. But I think past life work would certainly help.
Yeah, well, it's know thyself. And hopefully be able to work around it, you know, the good and the warts and all. It's just, I don't know. I think, I don't know where we get these thoughts about things are a certain way and they have to be like that. And you should never find out about what happened before because it can only hurt you. And, you know, all this stuff. Everybody has such a rigid sensibility about things.
Yeah, some people have very loud voices and very big opinions, you know. And I think that often what happens is if you are into this, a lot of us are quite sensitive, and I don't just necessarily mean because Granny's standing behind us and is able to talk to us. I mean we're sensitive in life, aren't we? But don't mistake your sensitivity for being delicate. You know, don't mistake it for that at all, because your sensitivity could be your strength. And I think when I hear other people impart opinions that I may not agree with, my usual thing is to just be quiet and think, well, yeah, that's absolutely fine. You think what you like, but I don't agree with you. And I, quite frankly, will do what I want to do anyway. Sometimes I have been burnt by that. I can tell you, sometimes I didn't listen to my teacher and I learned a lesson, and so be it, you know, so be it. But it was never, ever at the hands of a past life. That's for sure. The only thing past lives ever brought me is, more questions, but a whole lot of answers, you know?
Yeah. And, you know, we've talked about this on past shows about knowing where you came from will get you where you're going, and will certainly make things easier as you go along. You know, sure, what causes, what the root causes are, you know, people with phobias and things like that, or, you know, where did you get that funny looking scar on your arm? You know, well, I don't know, that kind of thing. And that gives you a key to the personality, or plural personalities, that you've had before, but it all just keeps progressing. And, you know, that's why people always think, okay, well, this is it. I'm done. I know, like we were talking about earlier. Yeah. Don't need to go any farther. And, you know, I always think that if you stop thinking that there is farther to go, you might as well dig your own hole. It may not be the universe's choice to take you then, but, you know, you might as well dig your own hole, because there's never a point that we should stop learning, should stop being inquisitive. And along with that comes more life lessons, and some of them are painful. But again, we need that. We need that to move on.
Absolutely. And these are the sorts of things that the Q can really help with, because if you, instead of looking at the Kabbalah as the symbol of the tree of life as a teaching tool, which it most definitely is, and as you learn it and build that on you, you know, you will learn the safari, you will learn the paths, all of that. But then a great way of using it is to say, okay, here's an issue, here's a problem I have. Where am I on the tree of life? And by that time, you will know exactly where you are on the tree of life, so where the particular problem is. And now working backwards, how can I kickstart something in my life by doing a temple or by doing a path working to attract it into my life, which is how the Kabbalah works. So we often get caught, humanity gets caught between devil, art, and death on the tree of life. So if you think of the tarot cards of the devil, art, and death, art, I think, is in other packs is temperance, I think. Mm-hmm. So we look at illusions, we look at the fear of letting go, and for us artists is the ability to mix things properly, like mix oil and water and make it work, you know. Mm-hmm. So, but if you look at that and think, okay, where am I? If I'm stuck on the devil, what do I need to do? I need clearer images. I need to know exactly what's happening. So I would go to the Safara of Hod, which is H-O-D. I would meditate in Hod for clarity of vision, and then I would expect it to come into my life. Mm-hmm. So that's the ritual magic side of it. Use your intellect and your knowledge to find out where to go. You go in the astral worlds, you sit in the temple of Hod, you draw towards you clarity and of images. You want to know exactly what's going on, because you want to take away the devil, the effects of the devil card, which is illusion. Mm-hmm. And then that will come into your life. Now, I did that with an ex-boyfriend of mine who was, I suspected, not being particularly faithful, and I was right. But Hod meditated on it, and it put it right in front of me in the form of an email that was just completely, you know, he couldn't deny, undeniable email. So mm-hmm. I had my truth, you know. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's it working in real life. So forget the wondrous temples, forget the amazing information, forget the incredible peace it brings in your life. That's the reality of it. It brings it right down to the point of, okay, you cheating on me or what? Do you know what I mean?
And, yeah, the straightforward approach, yeah.
Amazing. It's an amazing tool. It really is.
Now, you're talking about the tarot in conjunction with the tree of life and the major arcana. So does it start at the bottom with the fool and work its way all the way up to the world? Is that how it goes?
Yeah, it starts at the top for the fool and works all the way down to the universe. Oh. If you think about it, you start your spiritual journey from the fool, which is where he starts. Uh-huh. And then he ends at the universe path, which is actually between Yesod, Y-E-S-O-D, and Malkuth, which is the birth canal.
Okay.
So it actually goes the other way around.
All right. I'm, you know, left-handed, so I do things backwards, or who knows?
Yeah.
I'm the sinister one. What can I tell you? So, all right. So how would someone find a teacher?
This is the eternal question.
I know. It is. I know.
It's just so difficult. I mean, just from having to help other people or trying to help other people, I recognize just how blessed I truly was in finding Jenny Shell. You know, I really was. It's very difficult. You can try her website. Actually, is www.orderofthewhiteline.com, and she has amazing information on there. As for teachers locally, they're very difficult to find, I know. And, you know, if any are listening, please, please, no matter where you are in the world, email me through my website, davidwells.co.uk, and let me know what you're teaching, because I never have enough names. In fact, I don't have any, usually. Books are a nightmare, as you found out, I suspect.
Thank you very much. Yes, I did.
They are, aren't they, really? You know, uh-huh. Books are a nightmare.
The web isn't much help either. You know, Misinformation. I should have just called you, but hell, it wouldn't have made, it would have been too easy to call you and get all this first. No, I had to struggle. That's my life. On purpose. That's, to learn.
Yeah, well, I think, you know, it just, but it does go to show how difficult it is. And I think, I really never know how to advise people. Go to your local esoteric bookshop. They may know someone. With the queue, though, if you go along and it's too, perhaps, practical magic, or it's too psychological, or it's too some one way or the other, you know, don't, as with all teaching, if it's tarot or whatever it is, don't be afraid to say, you know what, not for me, you know.
Just trust open your gut. Up. Trust your gut. That's always a good way to start.
Yeah.
All right, well, we are flying by out of time, but I want to quickly find out what you've been up to lately. Any new books in the work? What's going on?
Just had a new book commissioned yesterday.
Ooh.
But I can't tell you any more about that. It'll be out next Christmas.
Oh, bother.
It's not the Kabbalah. One day, a simple guide to the Kabbalah. There's lots of... lots
Kabbalah
of good...
for dummies like me, yes. That
yeah, there probably is one of those, but even that, I guess, is complicated, I'll bet. There's lots of new stuff on the website, which is www.davidwells.co.uk. There's a new membership club called Wells Beings, which is really great because it's a way of getting people from all sorts of parts around the world, really. And if any of your listeners want to join the Wells Being Club, they also get a free 6-part psychic development course.
Wow.
So if they go on there and then when they join up, just say that they had that from me on your show, they can have that free from me, a 6-part course. I think it's £30 in dollars. I think it's $47. I'm not sure. But there's all sorts of things trying to build a stronger community of like-minded souls. You know what that one's like. It's working, though. Really, really nice people. And you know, it's actually something I've wanted to do for a while. And hopefully, if all things work out, that will transfer from the internet to something perhaps a bit more bricks and mortary, and also trying to do some online teaching. So, you know, webinars and things.
Well, definitely let me know when you're doing that, because I will be there with bells
Good.
On. Or wands on, or whatever, witch hats on, pointy
Little
shoes and all.
On.
There you go. Well, David, thank you so much for being here tonight. It was confusing, enlightening, and as always, a pleasure having you on. And I'm not sorry I chose this topic. I just had a wonderful week, and it jostled my brain, and now there's clarity, and this is always a good thing.
It's been a joy, as ever, Marla. Let's not leave it so long next time.
No, definitely. Definitely. We'll have to keep you up in the middle of the night so you can come on live one time.
Yeah, that's maybe once a year, you know, because
yeah.
I need to sleep in my own earth for 14 hours a day.
Well, I'm going to have that shovel, and I'm going to dig little potholes around you, and we'll make it happen. Maybe you'll be in the States one time, and we can work the time out better that way.
Well, you know what? I keep that in mind because I'm about to visit a friend of mine in L.A., and I will definitely give you a call when I'm there.
Well, you better. Otherwise, my wand is going to be pointing in your direction, and the sparks will fly.
I look forward to it.
The wand part? Oh, yeah, the sparks are always fun. All right. Well, we are out of here, guys. Thank you all for listening, and until next time, blessed be and merry meet again. Good night.
This has been another edition of Stirring the Cauldron with Marla Brooks. Be sure to tune in next week at the same time for another great guest and more fun. Any rebroadcast or other use of this program without permission is strictly prohibited. Copyright 2009.